I'm Linda Kidd, and I'm here in the Santa Rosa Valley at the door to the Deeper Love Studios of David Gallup and Nansi Balanska Gallup. Deeper Love Studio. I'm Nansi Gallup.
And I'm David Gallup, and we're in Santa Rosa Valley, and we'd love to show you our studio.
So welcome.
About 6 years ago, we asked Bill and Linda Kidd if they could help find us a new home with a beautiful studio attached. It was a lot to ask. We were looking for a very big studio with high ceilings, lots of natural north light, and we wanted to be in a beautiful setting with a lot of birds and wildlife and peace and quiet around us.
And they found it, and here we are enjoying it and feeling very blessed.
So what we're standing in right now is an 8-car garage. There's a 2-car garage remaining right behind this wall. And we've taken the 8-car garage, done a couple little modifications, put up a lot of our own lights, and the whole place is pretty much ready to go, and it makes a beautiful working studio.
Yeah, we're very, very, very happy, and we're always thankful to Linda and Bill Kidd for finding this beautiful home for us. So join us, we'll take you for a little tour, show you some of our equipment, some of our paintings, and hope you have a good time.
That was sweet.
All right. So we'd like to show you our palette. We'll start with our Pomalba white, a black. We don't always have black on our palette, but for today we do. Got Naples yellow, radiant red, radiant violet, radiant blue, radiant turquoise, radiant green. We've got radiant yellow. Then we go on to our yellow ochre, transparent earth orange, cad red light, cad orange, transparent orange, cad yellow, Indian yellow, cad lemon, Hansa yellow, chartreuse, cad green, permanent green, phthalo emerald, one of our new favorite colors, phthalo green, blue shade, cobalt teal, phthalo turquoise, phthalo blue, ultramarine, cobalt, dioxazine purple, alizarin, and quinacridone red.
When you think of what you need in the perfect studio, one of the first things you're going to need is easels and palettes. So let's just take a second and talk about what we've decided to do with that. You can see we have 6 of these palettes here in the studio. We've made them ourselves, and these are just simple 2x4s with a glass top on top of it. The glass top is painted with a primer gray on the back, so that as you look down on it, you're working on that nice gray surface. If you're working on a white surface, all of your colors are gonna look too dark. If you're working on a dark surface, all of your colors are gonna look too light. So that matte gray is just a perfect finish underneath this. You can see we also have a little place on the bottom where we can put things like the dog bed, or we can put any extra supplies and stuff like that that we want to use. The second thing you're gonna need in a studio, of course, is an easel. And we have a lot of them in this studio. This is David Sorg easel. Nancy and I have matching David Sorgs. I think they're discontinued right now, but hopefully they'll start making them again because these are really great. One of the features that I love about this easel is that you can move it up and down really easily. You don't have to crank it or, you know, move the top and bottom separately, any of that stuff. Another thing that's great with this, you can put your painting right at the edge of this and you have plenty of room below it. So if you're dragging with like a long-handled brush, dragging a stroke right off the bottom of the canvas, you're not running the handle into one of these trays or something like that. So it's a really well thought out easel, and that's one of the reasons we're going to design. If you follow me around over this way, that's my sword easel there, our drum kit. And we do have some stuff in the studio that is to remind us to be playful. And so that's one of the things. You may have also noticed the ping pong table. But we also have a wall-mounted easel here. And this one's great. It's on a crank. And it can hold really big pieces. So we're probably going to get actually another one of these to go over next to it so we can do massive pieces and work on those together, because I think that's in our future. And with these 12-foot high ceilings, I think we're going to be able to have a good way to do that here. If we keep looking around the room, you'll see we have a bunch of easels up and paintings are on these. One of the nice ways to work that we're able to do in this studio is if we have a piece that is being put together from a bunch of plein air pieces or other kinds of studies we've done, we can just put them up on easels and have them all around us. So as we're working on our major piece, we're surrounded by that fresh inspiration from our field notes.
One of the main challenges we faced in converting this space to a painting studio was lighting. Good light is more about having a full spectrum than it is about just having a lot of light. So we have designed our light with 5 different sources. As you can see, the north wall of our studio can be opened up completely with 4 garage doors, allowing 30 feet of beautiful north light to enter the studio, where it bounces off of the shiny floor and ceiling to give us a solid base of full spectrum ambient light. Upon that foundation, we have added broad spectrum fluorescence, incandescence, halogen, and LEDs to achieve an ideal lighting environment. This is a beautiful piece of equipment made for us by our brother-in-law, Robert Cebulski of Ventura Finish. And as you can see, it's a beautiful top, doesn't scratch. You can use razor blades on top of this and it's fine, but it's got a beautiful drawers. This top one is for our brushes, but we do our paints here. Some more paints here. Anyway, it's a lovely piece. These are our brushes that we like. We've been fans of Robert Simmons forever and ever. And we're recent fans of rosemary brushes. We really, really love these sables. They're absolutely beautiful. We also use sometimes big house brushes when the moment calls, even something as big as that. And we love squeegees. These we get on Amazon. They're probably our favorites. They don't last forever because we use them quite a bit.
One of our big philosophies in painting is that we are always trying to do something new, or at least new for us, but hopefully even new. And if the only thing you paint on is a painting that matters to you, you're never going to experience some of the places of freedom and creativity that you can get to if you have just little bits of canvas sitting around and you practice things. So for an example, if you look around at our studio here, we always have all these kind of like little bits of just canvas everywhere, just sitting around. And like, you know, this isn't a painting, but if we keep playing with it, we may find some areas that think, well, that could work sometime in a coral reef, or, you know, this could be an interesting way to try and treat this treatment of stripes on a fish or something like that. Or we could even just think about color harmony and how to work, you know, a transition of a cool to warm over a warm to cool, right? And just think about how we could do that with different tools and different textures. Compositional studies, just thoughts on design, you know? It could be something that simple, but it could turn into a painting that is very representational if we ever wanted to. So you see, just we have all of these stacks of things, and we're just experimenting with mark making, with color harmonies, with design thoughts. And that's one of the things that I think really helps this be a special and functional studio.
This is an interesting thing you'll find sometimes laying around our studio. This is a screen that they use for screen printing t-shirts or posters and things like that. And we've experimented with painting through these screens onto the painting to get different kinds of effects with marks. So if you, you know, put down a mark and then wipe it off on the back and then pull it off, you know, you might get something even like this right here. This is made with one of those screens just by putting really thick paint on with a lot of turp in it, letting it sit there, pull the screen off, and then when it dries, we have an effect like this, which you can see really works well for things like fan corals and things like that. But it's also just a way of making a mark that is an original mark. And so being able to play with these kinds of canvases and just having that available is something that we'd really recommend it for any artist. When I think about what a studio is or what a studio should be, I think of the word play. There's so much more to painting than just doing the work of painting, doing the hard technical kind of sides of painting, the things that feel more like work. So much of discovery happens in play. It's why all intelligent mammals have, you know, big parts of their brain set aside to play. We learn things when we're playing that we won't learn any other way. And so Nansi and I always make sure to try and keep the spirit of the studio playful. And that means having fun music or the ping pong table out here, the drum kit and other instruments. We're always laughing and we're always experimenting and we're always challenging ourselves to do a mark, make a mark that we haven't made before, even if it's a bad mark. Try something we've never tried before, even if it fails. And even if that mark goes on top of a painting that we both already were satisfied with, and even if it fails, we both still believe that that mark was worth making because we learned something from it, even if we learned what not to do.
When I think of what a studio is, I think of the word potential. Every time I walk into our studio, I think of what could be. What could we create? One of the greatest things about being a painter is that there is nothing to stop us from doing our best work, achieving our potential. No limits, no guidelines, no rules, so long as we manage not to put those onto ourselves. So I guess you could say that a studio is the physical manifestation of the concept of freedom.
What were the steps that led you to having this career?
Well, I've always been a painter my entire life, even as a kid, drawing, painting. And in undergraduate, I studied art, theater, film, marketing, advertising. So a little bit of always more toward the creative side of business if I had to do business, because I had this feeling in my brain that I probably had to establish a career beyond my painting to make a little bit of money.
That's a good
in
feeling.
My 20s.
I didn't always have that feeling, but it's a good, I'm glad you did.
Yeah.
We had a little different approach, you and I, because you felt like, I had to go out and make some money and then I can then I can paint whatever I want. And I kind of came out of school and thought, well, I'm going to paint whatever I want and I imagine that's going to turn into money.
Right? So, that wasn't even in high school even you had that.
Oh yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, even in high school I had that. And so first I started teaching for Mission Renaissance Art Schools. And so I got to be, I had a studio there. That was my first time I ever had a studio.
And you love that person who owned that operation.
Larry, yeah. He was a great guy, And he was, you know, really the first real working artist that I knew. You know, I had known illustrators, you know, even well-known illustrators. But Larry was someone who just was a painter. And he worked in oil. I got to just learn how to teach. And you know, I fell in love with teaching, of course. I still am teaching all the time. I've tried to quit a couple of times in my life, but it turns out
all I do is quit taking money for it, and still I'm walking around teaching all the time.
Pulls you back in.
I can't resist it. I have this need to sort of share. And
you're a natural teacher.
I'm a natural
teacher. You're an absolutely natural teacher.
So flash forward 20 years, and now I've got 3 solo museum shows behind me. We have one together. And we've discovered all of this underwater world that has just opened up new avenues in painting and new sources of inspiration for us. And what a beautiful place to be right now at this point in our lives.
Let's talk about our collaborations. I know a lot of people are mystified or curious about our process. Would you like to talk about it a bit?
Yeah, it is an unusual thing that we do. Mm-hmm. And it was something that was very natural for us, I think, in
yes,
the evolution.
Yes, very natural for us.
I think one of the things that surprises people about collaboration is that it seems that making that mark is the real work of doing the painting. Mm-hmm. But that's a myth, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
The real work of doing a painting isn't the physical act of moving the paint to the canvas. You know, the real challenge and the real process of creating art comes from having the ideas mm-hmm. and where to put the mark and what the mark should look like. Mm-hmm. We're both trained enough that either one of us can make that mark once we know what mark to make and where to make it, right?
Yes.
So this is probably the thing that confuses people, that they don't understand.
The conceptual part.
They think that we're just going to be like elbowing each other out of the way to like make the mark. But in the end, I don't think you care, and I don't care which one of us makes the mark.
No.
Putting a painting together by way of conversation mm-hmm. is such an exciting way to work, you
it
know?
Is.
The idea that we can step back and say, what do you think if we brought the energy flow in from the left instead of from the top on this piece? And then you might say, well, how would you want to do that? And I said, what if I put a shark coming in over here? And you said, what if it was just light, you know, coming in over here? And then we, you know, we quiet that area down, but it's still a passage in. And I said, I'm not sure what you're talking about, but can you show me? Mm-hmm. And then you just walk up to a painting that we've done all this work on, and like with maybe a roller or something, and just put a shape of light coming into the piece.
I'm thinking more about when we were doing, starting out Deeper Love, and just how many iterations we went from a shark being there, our tabletop coral, and that it just kept changing and changing, but we didn't mind the change. It felt like it was an evolution. And then that was part of the growth of that piece was just the either eliminating things or putting new things in. It's a journey. Each canvas is its own journey. And I never feel that it's, rarely do I say, oh man, you know, I really, really like the last version of that better. It's always growing, you know, it's just part of the love of that piece.
Yeah. That said, you know, we both are people who defend making that mark, you know, mm-hmm. shoot first and ask questions later, no. right? Let's just put a mark up there. And the idea that no mark is a wrong mark until you've signed the painting.
Absolutely.
That there is no such thing as a mistake, that everything is just process.
There is no such thing as a mistake.
That way, you know, without that freedom to mm-hmm. put a mark and not be afraid that you're going to be like, oh, I liked it better before.
Right.
Even if you did like it better before, you still appreciate me making the mark and doing my best.
Absolutely.
And that's the work. And I'm the same with you.
Yeah.
If, you know, you could cover up, you know, a fish that I absolutely loved in a piece, but, you know, you're working and you're, you know, mm-hmm. you're doing your thing, and we're just, it's part of the evolution. If that fish goes away, it may come back, it may not. That mark that you made may stay, or it may just inspire some other thought that
yes.
happens on another part of the canvas mm-hmm. or on the next painting.
Absolutely.
But knowing that that mark has value always keeps us, I think, from regretting a mark or being
right.
timid to make a mark.
Yes.
You can't be afraid that you're going to regret a mark, or you'll be timid
absolutely.
Through the whole thing. And nobody wants to see a timid
no.
painting. I sure don't.
And I think it's especially true well, probably for any size painting, but I think the bigger the painting is, the more you even realize the growth is going to be in the evolution of that piece. And it's, you just have to keep putting the marks.
What is it about painting an underwater subject other than, you know, that it really hasn't been done, right? Because it's one of the most beautiful parts of life on Earth is if you can stick your face in the water, even with a snorkel mask, and see a coral reef. It's this alien visit to an alien world,
it is
something that, you know, as we're always looking for originality in our work, it's something that just hasn't been taken on in a sophisticated way that we've ever found, right? But beyond that, what is it that, you know, keeps you coming back to the canvas? What is it, where is it that you're finding so much meaning, and where do you get all your drive to come to the canvas and do more and more of these underwater scenes?
Well, I think what keeps bringing me back to, and us back, I think, is this idea that maybe we can make a difference with these paintings. How amazing it would be to actually change someone's mind. Like, maybe I won't use a plastic straw today because it's probably going to end up in the ocean somewhere. What if we can do that? That would be pretty meaningful. That would be pretty incredible.
The artist activist is something that has been around for a long time, right? And you have you have civil rights artists, and you have politically based artists. You have environmental artists for sure. But who's really taken on the ocean? You have some actually great filmmakers doing it.
Yes.
We have some great photographers doing it. And there are some painters trying to do it, but I think that our particular experience in putting together more academic paintings and weaving that in with pop art and cubist philosophies and, you know, these kind of contemporary high art concepts that aim to do museum type of pieces. That's something that's still very fresh.
It is fresh.
And being able to put together museum shows that deal with, you know, that balance of showing the beauty of our world and also, you know, informing the public even a little bit that there are things they can do in their daily lives that can really make a difference in saving coral reefs for our children.
Absolutely.
And why coral reefs are important. So we're working on a show right now. And this has been the case, I think, for both of us when we put together museum shows before. We put together the museum show and then find the places that are going to take it. In the same way that we do a painting and then find a collector instead of trying to paint for a market.
Absolutely.
Right? And so right now we're working on our next major museum exhibition and not knowing quite where it's going to go yet. But we would love to really get into what the life of the coral reef is like and what the visual possibilities are for that, and hopefully help people fall in love a little bit deeper with the ocean. You know, our friend Wyland has a big thing written when you go to his gallery in Laguna that says people protect what they love. And how could you not love a coral reef once you've seen it, once you've experienced it?
Right? We've been so fortunate and very blessed to be able to travel around the world and scuba dive in some amazing places. Our favorites, oh, I don't know if there's a favorite, but we love Tahiti, we love Rangiroa, Bora Bora. And our current works, our coral reef that we're currently working on is from that area. But we also have been blessed to go to Turks and Caicos and Belize and Fiji. And we have a trip planned for Raja Ampat, which is part of the Coral Triangle. And we're going to be able to see some of the most beautiful coral in the world.
I'm hoping that, you know, as we experience these things and we turn them into paintings, it just brings to people's minds, you know, wow, there's something so special about
this.
So
sacred, it's sacred waters.
And, you know, the way so far humans have been treating coral reefs is kind of the way we treat all of nature, you know, pretty roughly. And having lost 50% of our coral reefs since the 1950s, you know, we have to really start taking all this stuff seriously. And if we can, you know, accomplish anything with our work at all, I would hope it would be just to raise some awareness of what we're doing to our oceans.
Absolutely.